there's your stand.
Okay.
But there's no chair.
Just had to check the candle, make sure it worked or
something. Yeah. The candle lighter should. So you have remarks to make about.
Yes.
So read those and then just go light one of the candles. And the lighter should be right there.
Okay.
Close.
Just one of the.
And then back down.
And your video taper girl.
Good morning. Welcome to our service this morning, the first Sunday of Advent. A couple of things I want to mention to you before we begin the formal worship. And that is, you'll notice the mics at the organ. We were informed late in the week after the bulletins had already been made that Sarah tested positive and is now sequestered all by herself. So we really appreciate Mike's being here. The prelude that he will be playing, Sleeper's Wake, is based on the tune that we will sing as the first hymn. So while you listen to the prelude, you might want to turn to hymn number 349 and meditate on the text that is there that you will be singing in just a few moments. And otherwise, I think we're ready to begin. Notice all the opportunities for service in the insert in your bulletin. Do any of you have any announcements that you need to be made? If not, I'll turn it over to Carrie for the lighting of the Advent candle. Oh, no. Sorry. I have to have the prelude first. So, Mike, if you're ready. Thank you.
Our call to worship this Advent season will be our Advent readings we read before we light the candle. Hear these words. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Today we remember the prophets of old who demanded to be heard, who dared to speak of a child to come, unexpected liberator of the people, vulnerable incarnation of the holiest of holies, a new name for God. Today we give thanks for the prophets among us, who bring to us surprising new visions of hope, who challenge us to think outside the box, who show us a future we never anticipated. On this first Sunday of Advent, we light this candle as a symbol of the prophets who renew our faith and remind us of what may be. Please stand as you're able for our first hymn, number 349 in the hymnal, Sleepers Wake, A Voice Astounds Us.
Thank you.
deacons in the church, we seek to leave behind our past unfaithfulness. We remember our doubts and neglect, the empty times we pray when prayer is forgotten and our focus is narrowed to petty concerns. We will pray together the prayer of confession printed in your bulletin, followed by a moment of silent prayer of confession. Let us pray. Awesome God, we confess the sin of our separation from you. We have blamed you for hiding from us, rather than admitting we have failed to see you in the thousands of ways you are revealing yourself every day. We have not called on you, and we have not listened for your call to us. Without you, we have become tiny islands of self-concern. Our links with the rest of your children are stretched and broken. Oh God, we long for that loving community in which your reign is acknowledged and your purposes are served. Move us to that place, we pray. God's grace has come to us in Jesus Christ. God restores us to a right relationship with the eternal, that we might rightfully value ourselves and all persons. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Let us sing glory to God. Testament lesson is found in Isaiah 64, verses 1 through 9 on page 531 in your pew Bible. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains would tremble before you, as when fire sets twigs ablaze and causes water to boil. Come down to make your name known to your enemies and cause the nations to quake before you. For when you did awesome things that we did not expect, you came down and the mountains trembled before you. Since ancient times, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who acts on behalf of those who wait for him. You come to the help of those who gladly do right, who remember your ways. But when we continued to sin against them, you were angry. How then can we be saved? All of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away. No one calls on your name or strives to lay hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and made us waste away because of our sins. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, you are the potter, and we are all the work of your hand. Do not be angry beyond measure, O Lord. Do not remember our sins forever. O, look upon us, we pray, for we are your people. Oh.
Our gospel lesson for the morning is taken from the book Gospel of Mark, chapter 13, which is known as the Little Apocalypse, beginning with verse 24. Now this scripture may, at first glance, seem to be a bit strange. We're entering the season of Advent. And for these four Sundays, we're preparing ourselves for the coming of the Christ child. So why is this passage included in the lectionary for the first Sunday in Advent? But in those days, following that distress, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky. Heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, men will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory, and he will send his angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. Now learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its twigs get tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. Even so, when you see these things happen, you know that it is near, right at the door. I tell you the truth, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. No one knows about that day or hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard. Be alert. You do not know when the time will come. It's like a man going away. He leaves his house and puts his servants in charge, each with his assigned task, and tells the one at the door to keep watch. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know when the owner of the house will come back. Whether in the evening, or at midnight, or when the rooster crows, or at dawn. If he comes suddenly, do not let him find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to everyone, watch. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Talk with us, Lord. Reveal yourself. And let the kindling of your love warm our hearts. Amen. So, what are we as a worshiping community supposed to be doing in this period? We're inundated with activities this time of year. We've just celebrated the Thanksgiving season. Our senses have been overwhelmed for months by Christmas advertising, putting up decorations, shopping, visiting. So what does the church say is the message of the season? Here's a quote from the Book of Common Worship describing Advent. Advent is a four-week period in which the church, rejoicing in Christ's first coming, eagerly looks forward to Christ's coming again. The Old Testament reading approaches the subject from the point of view that God comes to us rather than waiting for us to come to him. He told Samuel to pick a young shepherd, to be Israel's prototypical king. He asked Isaiah of Jerusalem, to whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Francis Thompson has written a poem entitled The Hound of Heaven, in which the soul running away from God is pursued by God as a sent a big old scary angel to a teenage girl, telling her that she was privileged to be the unwed mother of the Messiah. And in the Old Testament, 2 Isaiah, the prophet in the exile, speaks in chapter 65, verse 4, God, who acts on behalf of those who wait for him. We mustn't be bustling interferers, but patient subordinates, quietly looking for his signals to come into his plans. God was occupied in the tasks we're called to fulfill before he calls us to those tasks. Now let's look again at what Mark is saying in our gospel reading. The basic idea here is a warning against confusing religious institutions with the kingdom of God, thinking that God's future is tied to their success or failure. The electrifying message is the good news of the gospel. The Greek word for gospel is euangelion. Yes, angel is included in that. This is the good news that God has come to us. And in this passage, it means the good news of the end of the world. Now we can explain watch literally as expecting an immediate return of Jesus. This is especially true among oppressed people, like African American slaves who sang, "Lord, if I got my ticket, can I rise all the way to heaven this morning?" A second option is to realize the future hope in terms that offer pragmatic guidance for the present. That means that even though we have hope for the future, we still have opportunities for service in the present. They're all around us, although we often miss them. Sometimes God has to smack us upside the head before we recognize the opportunity. One of the opportunities is also one of the most difficult, but it may be as simple as being pleasant to an unpleasant purpose. In a few moments, in our prayer time, we'll have as our bidding prayer the opportunity to pray for those we don't like. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, "Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you." Dave Brubeck uses this text in his oratorio. What is the name of the Light in the Wilderness. And he deliberately set that text to very, very difficult music. Because as he said, this is one of the most difficult things we're called upon to do. Now this leads us to the third option, that the kingdom of God is the kingship of God in our own experience. This interpretation is individual and inward. It understands eschatology in terms of the quality of present existence, for it anticipates an encounter with Christ. This scripture comes around in the lectionary every 3 years. And the regularity of Christmas can make genuine expectancy difficult. This chapter speaks to those who expect too much, and those who expect too little. It's especially pertinent to those who have forgotten to expect anything at all. That is why the hymn we sang at the beginning of this service is so pertinent to this service. Although its basic reference is to the parable of the wise and foolish bridesmaids in Matthew 25, it fits the ideas set forth in this passage. Those of us who previously knew this hymn know it in the translation made by Catherine Wentworth in 1858, "Wake, awake, for night is flying." That's the text I've sung for the past 60 years or so. And that's why the use of the word astounds in the text and the title grabbed my attention. We should be astounded that God chose to reveal himself to us in the way he did. Our task is very simple. In the words of Psalm 27, verse 14, and here the poetry of the King James Version really stands out. Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thy heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. One of the classics of Christian literature is The Quest of the Historical Jesus by Albert Schweitzer. He closes his book with these words. He comes to us as one unknown, without a name. As of old, by the lakeside, he came to those men who knew him not. He speaks to us in the same words, follow thou me, and sets us to the tasks which he has to fulfill for our time. He commands, and to those who obey him, whether they be wise or simple, he will reveal himself in the toils, the conflicts, the sufferings which they shall pass through in his fellowship, and as an ineffable mystery, they shall learn in their own experience who he is. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our hymn is in from your hymnal number 384, Soon and Very Soon. Affirmation of faith, the ecumenical apostles. Once again, I would call your attention to the opportunities for prayer and service on your bulletin insert for this Sunday and for the month of December. Val, do you have?
Yes, we have a card in the back for Jerry Wright. Jerry had surgery for cancer and went to jail last week, and I didn't get that, but I'm sorry. We need to send him a card. He's been so much around, so many ways for him to be sure to keep him in our prayers. Also, there's a card for Jerry Fox. You may remember Jerry suffered injury and is paraplegic. They discovered cancer, and I cannot tell you where other people are sitting between them in Milchad. And then also, we're sending messages of love and missing you to Maxwell, who's the Presbyterian man, or Parsons, and Marianne Holly, who is living with her daughter Lisa in Melissa, Texas. And also, I'd like to share you the last week, I believe it was, we sent a card a week before to Jack Anderson, Sherry's daughter, who had surgery for cancer. And she heard back from her. She says, "Oh my gosh, your people are such sweet people. This brought tears to my eyes. Thank you, everyone. I felt the love." So, our cards do reach people. Please be sure, if nothing else, just sign your name, because that way they know when they need help.
Are there any other prayer requests or updates? Any more requests? Now, in our prayers this morning, we're going to do what we call a bidding prayer, in which I will give you suggestions for your prayer, and then we'll have a period of silence for you to include your own. So let us go to God in prayer. Father, whose Son Jesus Christ taught us to pray, let our prayers for others be the kind we want, and not just ways of getting what we want, who already have so much in Jesus Christ our Savior. Let us pray for the church. Gracious God, you called us to be the Church of Jesus Christ. Keep us one in faith and service, breaking bread together and telling the good news to the world, that men may believe that you are God and live to give you glory. Let us pray for worship in the church. God, you call us to worship, and by your Spirit prompt prayers and praise. Keep us from saying words or singing hymns with ritual and disinterest. Fill us with such wonder that we may worship you, grateful for the mystery of your unfailing love for us in Jesus Christ the Lord. Almighty God, ruler of men, direct those who make, administer, and judge our laws. For President Trump, for President-elect Biden, and others in authority among us, that led by your wisdom, it may lead us in the way of righteousness. Let us pray for the sick and needy. Merciful God, you bear the heart, the hurt of the world. Look with compassion on those who are sick and who need you. Cheer them by your word and bring health, comfort, and encouragement as a sign that in your promised kingdom there will be no more pain or crying through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us pray for friends and families. Bless us and those we love, our friends and families, that drawing close to you, we may be drawn closer to each other. We pray especially for Jerry, Savannah, Eddie, Jesse, Marilyn, Joan, Dennis, Connie, Cindy, Bev, Eric. closing hymn is number 87. I'm throwing a couple of tricky rhythms at you at this point. This is another one. It's a little bit tricky, so I've asked Mike to play the entire hymn through for his introduction so he can get some idea. You who are musically inclined, knowledgeable about music. It's a combination of three and two. Listen carefully as Mike plays it all the way through. Strength